Now, the limitations of the revisional powers, the next part in this heading would be that prohibition under section 397 subsection 3 with reference to inherent powers of the High Court. Now, though this is not a module dealing with inherent powers of the court, but here I would like to tell you that inherent powers as provided in a section 482 CRPC is something that is with an objective to empower the High Court with those powers which are not present in the CRPC expressly and which are needed to be exercised to correct any miscarriage of justice. So, if in the interest of justice, the High Court is required or is it is beneficiary, it is beneficiary in the interest of justice that High Court exercises that power, then the High Court exercises inherent power under section 482 CRPC. Now, the Supreme Court in Madhu Limaye versus State of Maharashtra held that if an impugned order brings about a situation which is an abuse of process of the court or for the purpose of securing the ends of justice, interference by the High Court is absolutely necessary, then nothing contained in section 397(2) can limit or affect the exercise of the inherent power of the High Court. Now, what do you mean by this? Actually, you need to be very clear about this, and you must be knowing also that there is a bar on going to the High Court again once the revisional jurisdiction is being exercised by the Session Court. Now, what will happen here is that once the party doesn't get a relief in Section 397, suppose it goes to the Session Court and it doesn't get a relief, then the remedy lies, though the remedy doesn't lies in revisional jurisdiction, but can, now the question is, can the party go to the High Court under inherent jurisdiction? Can it invoke the inherent jurisdiction? Why? Because there is a interest, there is an interest of justice that is being prejudicially affected, and therefore 482 needs to be invoked. Now, here, as I have said it, that in Madhu Limaye and versus State of Maharashtra, the court categorically said that section 482 cannot be limited by the bar that is being imposed by section 397 subsection 2. So, thereby meaning that if the court feels so, that is the High Court feels so, that there has been a miscarriage of justice, then in that case, though the matter has been dealt in the revisional jurisdiction earlier also under section 397 by the Session Court, still the High Court can exercise its inherent power for the correction of any illegality or irregularity that is being caused in the inherent by the inferior courts. Now, again, this decision of Madhu Limaye was affirmed again by the Supreme Court in Raj Kapoor versus Delhi administration, where it reiterated that even in respect of intermediate orders. Now, before I tell you the judgment of this particular case, I would like here to draw your attention on one simple thing, is that in inherent powers, the restriction on entertaining intermediate power in interlocutory orders, that is not placed. So, the High Court can very well entertain the interlocutory orders in inherent powers as well. So, again, coming back to Raj Kapoor versus Delhi administration, the Supreme Court reiterated that even in respect of intermediate orders, section 397 subsection 2 is no bar, and the inherent jurisdiction can be exercised if a case is made out to the exercise of the later power. Again and again, I am being using the word interlocutory order. So, you must be thinking that what interlocutory order is. But because if you will go through the CRPC provision, you won't find there. So, interlocutory order, first of all, it is very clear that it is not defined. So, when Supreme Court, and this was the reason the High Courts, the various High Courts were interpreting the term in their own way, and there were so many contradictory decisions coming on as far as the meaning of interlocutory order is concerned. So, Supreme Court in Amarnath versus State of Haryana held that the interlocutory order denotes orders of purely interim or temporary nature. They do not touch or decide the important rights or the liabilities of the parties and are merely a step in aid to adjudicate the rights. That means they are simply an aid to the procedure that is there in the criminal proceeding. They are not deciding on any of the substantive rights as per according to the decision given by the Supreme Court in Amarnath, where it discussed the definition of interlocutory orders. Now, again, in Madhulemai, while dealing with the same question, the court held. Now, interestingly, here the court came up with a different category of offenses. That is, the orders which are not purely interlocutory, but are not final as well. So, they are lying somewhere in between interlocutory and final. And in Madhulemai, the court actually held that the word interlocutory is not to be understood as something which is in converse with the final orders, thereby meaning that the opposite of final order is not interlocutory. There is something in between both of these, and these are intermediate orders. Now, as far as intermediate order is concerned, I would like to tell you that interlocutory orders, the bar is there. Final orders, the bar is not there. That means revisional jurisdiction can be exercised regarding final orders. But as far as the intermediate orders are concerned, again, the Madhulemai, the decision given in Madhulemai, then in Parmeshwari Devi, V.C. Shukla, and likewise, the court categorically said that regarding intermediate orders, the revisional jurisdiction can very well be invoked. That means it has liberally interpreted the meaning of interlocutory order, thereby bringing in scope those orders also which neither are interlocutory or which are neither final. Again, coming back to one, you can see the various orders, the various examples of intermediate orders. Now, final orders and intermediary orders, and then interlocutory orders. Now, as far as interlocutory order is concerned, for example, summoning the person, but summoning also can lie in other categories depending upon the right which it is touching. Now, as far as intermediary orders are concerned, order framing of charge, order summoning an accused, order deciding to take cognizance, these are being held in various decisions as being intermediate orders. Now, correction by High Court under revisional jurisdiction and Article 227 of the Constitution. Because, see, as I have told you earlier also, that the review procedure that is given in the CRPC can be categorized into appellate jurisdiction, can be categorized into revisional jurisdiction, can be categorized into 482, that is inherent powers of the superior of the High Court, and also the jurisdiction given to the High Court under Article 227, where again it can exercise the supervisory power over the proceedings which are being conducted in the inferior courts. Now, but there is a difference between both of them, and a comparison can be drawn very safely between both of them. Now, first of all, when exercising its power under Article 397 CRPC, the High Court can consider the correctness, legality, or propriety of any finding, sentence, or order recorded or passed, and the regularity of any proceeding of such inferior court. Secondly, under Article 227 of the Constitution, the High Court exercises superintendence over all the courts and tribunals and has the power to interfere and to see that the courts and tribunals exercise the function within the limits of their authority. Thirdly, under Article 227 of the Constitution, the High Court exercises a supervisory and not an appellate jurisdiction, as you must be knowing also, and considers the area of the inferior jurisdiction and the qualification and condition of its exercise. Now, the legislative policy of not allowing a second revision before the High Court at the instance of the party who has lost the first revision cannot be relied upon to affect the jurisdiction of the High Court under Article 227 of the Constitution, meaning thereby that the manner in which I have told you that 482, Section 482 cannot be circumscribed by Section 397, it cannot be limited by Section 397 in the same manner. The courts have again and again reiterated that Article 227 cannot be limited by Section 397. Though it is very well correct and it is the policy and that policy that is being again and again reiterated by the court, that the second revision is expressly prohibited in CRPC provision. Therefore, when the High Court is exercising its power under Section 482 CRPC or under Article 227 Indian Constitution, then in that case, it should use in exceptional circumstances. That is something that is important. And not only in exceptional circumstances, what are those exceptional circumstances? It has clarified again and again, saying that the court has to look into the matter expressly, thereby coming to a conclusion before entertaining it in Section 482 or 227, Article 227, that there is a clear-cut violation of the legal principles or established legal principles, or there has been a miscarriage of justice which is causing prejudice to the accused. So Article 227 also and Section 482 cannot be circumscribed by 397, which puts them in a different category altogether. So this is one thing that you have to be very cautious about. Now the concluding this module, I would like to say that by virtue of revisional jurisdiction, very wide powers are conferred on the High Court and Session Court, but such jurisdiction should be exercised within the four corners of Section 397. That means to say, it does not depend on the whims and fancies of the court as such to invoke, to get into the revisional jurisdiction where it is not necessary. Revisional jurisdiction is to be exercised only in exceptional cases where there is a glaring defect in the procedure or there is a manifest error on the point of law. Now, summarizing the entire thing, yes, the revision can be filed only once. Scope of revision, again, it is subject to, it is there to be exercised very rarely. Then limitations, which we have discussed earlier, that it cannot be used regarding interlocutory powers, it cannot be used by the same person again and again, and likewise. Then yes, we have compared in detail the difference between Article 227, 482 and Section 397. So by this, I hope you are clear now with the revisional jurisdiction which is being there with the High Court and Session Court. And if there is any confusion regarding any point, I would be happy to receive any of the queries there on the online forum, which I would be answering. And now, all the best for your exams. And I hope you do well in your exams. All the best. Thank you.